Hi guys, GoldenTalesGeek here. Welcome to my LI Who video. Yay! But seriously, just wearing my the 8th Doctor frock coat that Kate had made for me, which is where I got this thing, and also have my little Sonic screw 12th Doctor Sonic screwdriver here that she also gave me, and also wearing my Tom Baker scarf and my Seal of Rassilon t-shirt. But I just kind of wanted to basically introduce this video, and then I'll be back at the end of it after you've seen all the different pictures and stuff I have and stuff, and also some footage I took, like took of some of the things at the con, to talk about some other experiences that I had at the con that I didn't get on camera or whatever, or even just in some cases, you know, I didn't, or just some things that I'll never forget, really, because it's just, it was a real worthwhile experience. So let me just, with a wave of my 12th Doctor Sonic here, we will get things started. So I'll see you guys after all the other stuff is done and dusted. So be right back.
Hi guys, GoldenTalesGeek here. Welcome to my vlogging thing for LI Who. We're on the road right now. We're passing through the George Washington Bridge, and we're in New York pretty much, yeah. And Kate's sitting next to me driving, getting out before that. Behind us is Kate's friend.
Hi!
Yeah, she's dressed up as River Song.
Which way am I going?
I'm just kind of dressed in an amalgamation of different.
Ah, you said right!
Turn left, right, front, left, front, right, front.
We'll stay in the right lane, but stay straight.
Oh my god. Okay, what am I
doing? I-95 north.
As you can see, we're trying to do the directions as best we can.
Oh my god.
Hopefully we'll get
there
in one piece.
I-95 north to the cross.
Alternate to 95, okay.
Yeah. Oh, and
oh my god, I'm driving.
It's a little bit of a treat. My Kate here, God bless her, she got me a 12th Doctor Sonic screwdriver, so.
Great time to take a video when I'm panicking over driving in freaking New York.
Yeah, I know, right?
Hey, it's live, we're live capturing.
Anyway,
Hi.
Yeah. So, yeah, I'm with two women, who the funk, right? But anyway.
We're both river. Two rivers.
Yeah.
Badass temptress in front of the awkward corny guy.
Yeah. So whoever said two wrongs don't make a right, well, whatever. Anyway.
That was bad even for you.
Yeah, I know. Anyway.
You're not allowed to edit this.
I wasn't planning on it. It's part of the fun.
Okay.
Anyway, we'll see you when we get to the con.
Hey guys,
it's kind of crazy around here. We're looking at a 10th planet Cyberman. Sort of. I can't remember which Cyberman that's from. Probably Moon Base or something like that. I don't know. Sorry if it's kind of noisy. It says I'm putting subtitles or something in the video, but it's just so crazy around here.
Oh my god.
Everyone. Oh, I just saw a female first doctor. It's amazing. Anyway, see you guys later.
Oh,
tomorrow, or I'll have to carry them home with me. They make great Christmas presents. Glad to put your hand up at the end of the day, but I like investing in games. Pathetic. So, Peter, tell us, why did you still decide to write this book now, as opposed to, say, 10 years ago?
Well, I had more time on my hands, I think. I didn't know, something came to me. You know, people, at conventions over these people said, I didn't write an autobiography, and I never really took it seriously. Because I didn't think it was particularly interesting story to tell. But a friend of mine came, I think he was a ghost writer, I think he has been a ghost in my life, autobiographies before. And he said, you know, what do you think about doing an autobiography? And I had a bit of time in my head. I was just about to start Gypsy, actually. That was on TV last night.
Sorry, I'm recording for the panel.
This is about 15 months. I wrote it. But I don't know why. It seemed time to put my slightly fragmented life into some kind of order. But as I investigated my parents' life, my life, I found it was slightly more interesting than I thought. Because my father was from the West Indies. It seemed perfectly normal to me, but he's not most of it. Having a mum was interesting, and then I suppose I just ploughed on through my life, and it was quite fun. Now, there's something that we have to address.
Yeah, they are.
Okay, yeah. Worry about it, actually. There's only one sentence in capital letters in the book.
Yeah.
And it says, it was absolutely not my idea to kill Adric. We have to talk about this now, Peter. Well, it's absolutely true. I mean, the thing is that I suppose my problem was I thought it was a jolly good idea. I thought the idea that if your companion was going to leave, the idea of killing off a companion, you know, it wasn't very often done. It had been done once before, wasn't it? Yeah. I thought it would raise the stakes as far as the planet was concerned. So GXD didn't come to you and say, take your pet, who knows? Well, no, although I have to say, only by default that happened, because he wanted to get rid of Sarah, and I said, I don't want to get rid of Sarah. And then he said, how about Jerry? I said, why don't we want to get rid of Jerry? And then he said, how about Adric? I didn't say anything at all. Then he said to me, I've got a great idea, we're going to kill Adric off. He's going to die an heroic death. Which I thought was, you know, not a bad way to go. Matthew didn't agree. in his autobiography, was it an autobiography? It was kind of a story about anthropofaction, was it? He said that he didn't know. In fact, he did know. That's not true. He's misremembered that. But he did protest that he didn't think it was a good idea. Later, because he couldn't come back. He obviously thought we'd miss him so much that we'd bring him back. And indeed, even though we blew him up, he did come back. So we must have missed him, I guess. But I sort of changed my mind in the intervening years. About blowing him up. I don't know, because I think it affected people more than I anticipated it would do. Because there's a story, which is true, that when the series came back and my two young boys were fantastically passionate fans of Doctor Who, but especially of Rose, the character of Rose, there was a rumour that went around that said that Rose was going to die in the next week's episode. And I was so worried about this that I sent an email to Russell T. Davis, who is the producer, who had been a huge fan of the series around about the time I was doing it, when he was growing up. And I said, you know, my children are huge fans of Rose. If she does die, could you tell me? Because I'm not sure I should let them watch it. And he replied, just saying, you killed that. But it seemed like a good idea at the time, but it was not my idea. And that's what the camera letters are about. Just don't shift responsibility on a gentleman and tell her. Because he can't answer that. It's interesting because...
Now that is an astounding time is fleeting. If the madness takes its toll, but listen closely.
For how much longer?
Not for very much longer.
I've got to keep control.
Guys, back, and we're now leaving the con, so it was fun. A lot of fun things, great things happened. Nick Briggs liked my Jin impression. Kate did an After Dark thing to Time Warp from Rocky Horror, which was a real trip. Not sure if you're going to see it, but we'll see.
Yeah. Yes, which you may or may not see, because it's bad.
It wasn't that bad.
That, and also there's a chance I could get copyright cited from YouTube, so...
Like you care about that.
Yeah, I could care. Stuff. Anyway, another little... And also, Paul, again, really liked my Eighth Doctor t-shirt, so that was awesome as well. And got to say hi to Colin.
Yes, yeah.
and just all sorts of crazy things happen. So let's just hope the trip home works out smoothly. So see you later, folks.
Hey guys, we're back at Kate's house, and just thought I'd record a little postscript, and I'm about to go pack things up because I'm going to be leaving tomorrow morning, so, yeah, leaving today right after I go to the con. Sometimes fate deals you really a shitty hand, but it's when my parents wanted to leave, and I don't want to argue with them, but we had fun, it was great. Had a few laughs, met some great people. Yeah. I don't know when I'm going to be putting up this video, when it's done edited, but I just pray that you guys all enjoy the experience just as much as I did. So, till the next video, have a good one, guys.
Hi guys, we're back. Yay! I love this thing. It's just... first off, let me just compliment on this design of this new Sonic. I love the design of it. It's just... I know this sounds like a backhanded compliment, but I actually kind of like how over-designed it looks in a way, really, if you think about it. Just... And plus, I just love the color blue thing, and the blue and everything. It just looks almost like a logical extension of the TARDIS's internal circuitry, you know? Oh, well. I mean, don't get me wrong, I love 11 Sonic too, and it's just really a great piece of design work, and plus there's just the little claws at the end are really cool, but I don't know. Just this one, just all the different features, like, you know, green light, blue light, flick it twice, makes the rotating noise, and then flick it twice up, makes that alien noise. So cool, so cool. But anyway, enough about that. but seriously, what else is there to say? I almost wanted to get this on camera, but I ultimately decided not to. But there was something that happened before the air guitar thing that Kate did that you'll probably see on screen, see on camera. You know, where they called it Doctor Who Oki, where basically they play off a scene from Doctor Who's various history, whether it's a clip of something that's like of the scene from like either the classic series or the new series or what have you, and a specific character's dialogue has been blotted out and you have to recite the dialogue in that character's voice or just a close approximation to it. And I decided to do a scene from a Patrick Troughton serial. I can't remember the name of the story, but it had that infamous speech where he was saying something along the lines of, there are things in this universe beyond our understanding, things that, you know, that goes against everything we believe in, they must be fought, you know, that kind of thing, you know. And there, I was actually kind of competing with that scene with another guy who actually went the full cosplay as Pat Troughton's doctor, you know, with the bow tie clipped with the safety pin and everything, and just he was amazing. I mean, his cosplay was great. His karaoke thing was a little bit, but you know, in fact, I think my voice kind of went over pretty well with a lot of people there. Like I was just basically trying to do my best Patrick Troughton impression. Like, say, let's pretend this is the mic. You know, I was just basically something like, okay, Jamie, let's do, we must solve this problem if we are expected to survive. You know, something like that. I've been a little rusty, though. I haven't done the voice in a while. And to be honest, I have only been kind of practicing that. I had only been practicing that voice for about a month before deciding to do that little karaoke thing. But I'm trying to think what else that happened. I should probably show my lanyard here. See, here's my lanyard, you know, please, the little the little 8-bit silent there. It's really cool. Oh, and I got a few ribbons here. The good dog thing came from the picture you'll see of a gingerbread canine. They were passing them out to anyone who saw the gingerbread canine, and that included me. And I even asked if I could get a picture of it because it just looks so awesome. I mean, just a gingerbread canine. How can you go wrong? The Trust Your Auntie Iris is a reference to a character called Iris Wildtime, who was created by a writer named Paul Mars. Yeah, I'm a big Who fan that I know that shit. Yeah, she travels around in a double-decker bus and all that. And this one person who wore a Tom Baker scarf, not my like mine, but like an actual homemade Tom Baker scarf that his granddaughter knitted for him, which I thought was pretty awesome. You know, he was passing them out because he's a big Iris Wildtime fan, I think. Or maybe his wife is, because his wife attended the con with him, but she didn't dress up. And the Cyberman thing that says, "You will be like us, you shall be like us." That was from that 10th Planet Cyberman guy that I saw that, you know, I had to get my picture taken with him, and also Sonic him, and he was acting all like, you know, when I Sonic'd him. Even though, weirdly enough, at the time those type of Cybermen made their debut, the Doctor didn't have his Sonic screwdriver at the time. At least on screen. There was a First Doctor novel I remember reading about where the Doctor uses a device that's described as a little vibrating tube of some kind, which is implied to be the sonic screwdriver, but that's my lanyard. I didn't get as many ribbons as most people, unfortunately, but I didn't know where you could get most of these, to be honest. Otherwise I probably have a whole slew of them like most people have. I saw a really great I saw so many great cosplayers. There were so many amazing Seventh Doctor cosplayers. They even had the question mark knitted sweater vest and everything. It was just, I need to get one of those because I love a good sweater vest. I mean, my friend Rick on Facebook, he actually has one. And he says he gets him regular compliments at work because he works at NASA, which is kind of cool. And now he's a published author, actually. He's published a novel featuring Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart, and the story is called Times Squared, and it's supposed to take place in New York. So I might ask him if I can get a copy of that, even though I haven't had an interest in reading those Lethbridge Stewart novels, just so I can read, you know, his book and see that he's finally gotten his wish to write for the Hooniverse, even if he's not necessarily writing for the Doctor. So that I might ask him, can you send me a copy? Well, you know, because, you know, he's my friend, and we bonded over the fact that we're both fans of the Eighth Doctor, so if you couldn't tell by my frock coat here. But yeah, but I digress. I'm trying to think what else happened. You saw some pictures of me talking to somebody who has a Dalek casing open stuff. That was someone who actually made that Dalek casing himself and even had a headset kind of like mine, except not a USB one, where he could do the Dalek voice. But, and it's like, you know, and that was me doing the voice, you know, with my throat. I'm not, you know, not like the ring modulator effect, but it's still really, really cool. But Dalek fleet in battle formation, you know, exterminate, you know, but, yeah, Nick Briggs was such a... Speaking of Daleks, Nick Briggs actually was a really sweet guy. And the reason why you saw him in the picture of me wearing my Deerstalker hat is because I kind of asked him to. Because I just... Not only do I love his acting as the Daleks and all the other creatures and the Ice Warriors, for instance, and the Jadoon, which I actually did my Jadoon impression for him, and he was actually impressed. He raised his eyes like, "That's not bad, actually." But I'm trying to think. Why was I? Oh yeah, I told him I really liked his. The reason why I wanted him to wear my Deerstalker is because I loved how he played Sherlock Holmes on the Big Finish audios, and also the adaptation of the novel All Consuming Fire, because. It's just, and he's like, "Well, how would you describe my performance?" I'm like, "Well, I think it's kind of like an air of understated eccentricity, and he's kind of smiled, laughed, and said, "You know, I've never heard anyone describe any of my performances as understated before, so thank you." So that was kind of nice of him, and I love the fact that he put a little word bubble that said "exterminate" over his face. And I mean, I didn't wasn't really planning on getting his autograph. I just decided, what? I was just gonna go over and gush, and also due to my Jadoon impression. But I just figured, fuck it, I'll get his autograph. Yeah, it's only $20, you know, cheap compared to the other autographs. Oh yeah, I talked to some of the other actors on the show. Like I talked to Daphne Ashbrook, who played Grace, the Eighth Doctor's companion in the TV movie. She was a sweetheart. Yeah. I was great to talk to her, and she even said that Sylvester McCoy was actually going to be there at the LI Who that year, this year, but unfortunately he couldn't make it because apparently he had another acting commitment, and he wasn't able to come. Otherwise, I would have gotten his autograph. And although Kate is probably going to chide me for saying this, but she knows Sylvester McCoy more as Radagast the Brown from the Hobbit movies than she does as the Seventh Doctor. So, although she has seen that meme going around the internet where it's a picture of Radagast and it's River Song's quote, "I hate good fa wizards and fairy tales. They always turn out to be him." So, I mean, I had to explain that joke to her when she sent me that meme, and she's like, "Could you explain that to me? I'm really confused by the context of River's quote here." I'm like, "That's Sylvester McCoy. He plays Radagast and the Seventh Doctor." And she's like, "Ah." And then I said, "And then it's also implied in another story that the Doctor is also Merlin." And she's like, "Okay, that makes sense." So yeah. In fact, Erica, the other girl who was in the car with us, and Kate had to defer to me a lot when identifying cosplayers. Like, they saw this lady dressed up in a rather skin-tight, almost leather outfit, and having a gun holster and stuff, and having like a big ponytail. They're like, "Who is that?" And I'm like, "I think that's Ace after she left the Doctor and became a Dalek hunter. I'm not sure. Let me go check." And I went and checked, and I was right on the money. So they deferred to me for all the big Who knowledge because I know. I mean, I'm not a avid reader of the novels, but I do kind of have some idea of what the chronology of the story in the novels is, really, of Ace and how she gets back, she rejoins the Doctor and then leaves again after and all that. But yeah, I mean, but for the most part, I try not to. I don't know. I prefer. I mean, with the exception of my Engines of War novel, which is sitting around here somewhere. Which, if John Hurt ever shows up at a Doctor Who con any convention, I'm getting him to sign that. Even if he isn't the writer of the book, it still has his Doctor, and I would love to meet him, even if he wasn't playing the Doctor. So, yeah, I'm sorry, I'm just being an old John Hurt fanboy now. I might as well do my John Hurt impression to impress everyone on the internet. "Oh, for God's sake, Gallifrey stands!" Okay, that was not bad. That was bad, but whatever. "I am the Doctor again. Thank you." That should be better. I think that's better, but not by much. But yeah, I mean, it's just I'm trying to think. What else did I see? Oh, I saw someone do an Eighth Doctor cosplay, but it was in all dark colors and really kind of psychedelic colors as well. And I'm like, "Which Eighth Doctor are you supposed to be? I don't remember that outfit and all that." And she's like, "Oh, I'm supposed to be Zagreus." I'm like, "Audios, yes!" So that made me really happy. I almost wanted to take a picture of her, but I didn't get a chance to. So, I didn't get a picture of them in time, but I got to see up close the costumes of the fifth, sixth, and eighth Doctors. And oh my God, that eighth Doctor! I wanted to steal that frock coat so bad because it looked so good. It just, yeah. I mean, it's just, oh. And it was actual velvet too. I mean, I got to touch it a little bit. I was like, ooh. I mean, and the cravat was there, and the waistcoat just. The whole shebang, you know, and seeing six's multicolored coat there and five's, you know, out cricket gear, you know, I mean, oh, amazing stuff. Oh man, I'm just like Yeah. But, what else did I see? Peter Davison was really nice. I got to talk to him. My friend Kate got to talk to him a little bit after he signed my autograph, and he was signing hers. She actually had to make an apology to him because she met him before at a different convention where she didn't know Doctor Who at the time, and she was getting Peter's autograph for a friend of hers. And she was basically apologizing to him, saying, "Had I known you were in something this awesome, I was so dismissive, and I'm so ashamed, and I'm sorry." And he was just so amiable and polite about it, but he was also very glib about it. So, and I just kind of chimed in, like, "Isn't it good she's atoning for her sins?" And he's like, "Yes, it is. It's wonderful." So Peter was such an polite, affable man, much like his doctor, and not afraid to be snarky, just like his doctor. I mean, it almost feels like in some ways the doctor they play is almost like an extension of who they are. I mean, very much so with Tom Baker, but in some ways, you know, I mean, with the exception of Colin. I mean, Colin is the sweetest, most gentlemanly, self-deprecatingly witty man I've ever met. And yet his doctor is, pre-character development anyway, is probably one of the most abrasive, jerkish people I probably wouldn't want to meet. Unless he had some character development, which he did in the audios, so God bless him. Paul's doctor, yeah, he's very much kind of Paul himself, although his accent's kind of a combination of a Liverpudlian accent and what they call RP, or received pronunciation, or BBC British, if you want to get glib, accent. Which is kind of unique and makes his doctor very interesting. I mean, it's like he has the Liverpudlian in the cadence, but the RP in terms of pronunciation, I can't explain it. Especially if you don't know, if you're like me, an American you're like American like me, and you don't know what all the different British accents are. Hell, I don't even know the difference between a lot of the English accents, like Estuary and Northern, Liverpudlian or Mancunian, which is Christopher, or Mancurian as Chris Eccleston's accent or whatever. But yeah, I mean, speaking of Paul, he was such a vibrant, charming man. I mean, and I mean charming in a good way. He's just such a lovely guy. He loved my Eighth Doctor shirt, too. And he even asked where he could get one, and I told him it was unavailable anymore, but I'll mention it to the website if they could make them available again. He's like, "Darn it." So, yeah, that's a shame. But he still loved it. He still loved it, and I achieved my goal of wearing my Paul McGann Eighth Doctor playing card tee when meeting Paul McGann. My life is somewhat complete. I still need to meet all the other doctors who are still alive. You know, I'd have to get two autographs of Tom Baker, one for myself and one for my mother, because, you know, Tom is her doctor. But. Trying to think what else. I can't think of anything else that happened, really. When I talked to that Dalek operator, I told him, "Well, to be honest, I'm not gonna lie, I'm feeling sort of tempted to climb in this thing just to see what it's like, because I've always wanted to see what it's like to be inside a Dalek casing, but yeah, I don't think it's gonna. It didn't happen, so oh well. That's fine, though. That's fine." All sorts of crazy things. I mean, so many Sixth Doctor cosplayers. I was impressed because his hair wasn't all curly and stuff like Colin's, but the patchwork frock coat he had was spot on. I mean, it's just amazing. I don't know if he purchased like a reproduction of it or he had it made himself, but either way, I was impressed. I mean, that is just because the Sixth Doctor's costume is a hard thing to do. I mean, it really is when you get right down to it. It really is. I mean, the Fifth Doctor's costume is probably hard too because of the striped cricket trousers he was wearing. But for the most part, it's pretty simple and straightforward. Six's outfit. Oh my God, You'd have to probably be, you'd have to just have the patience of a saint to make that thing. But yeah. And in case you're to kind of clarify more on my Eighth Doctor frock coat, basically, Kate tricked, to be a blunt, Kate tricked me. She asked, she IM'd me out of the blue to ask what my measurements were because she was going to have a coat made up for a friend, Mike, who's about a similar build as I am, and he has a YouTube channel. So if you've seen him comment on some of my videos, you might know his channel. But, basically she said, well, could I get your measurements so I could, get a close approximation? And I'm like, and I didn't think much of it at the time. I mean, I kind of smelled a little bit of a rat, but I didn't think much of it at the time. She's like, okay. And she's like, okay, well, what? And I said, well, and she's, but for the most part, and she basically had one of her coworkers, who's an awesome seamstress, she works at a Joann fabric store, make this up for me and everything, and it had like silver lining in it to kind of convey the velveteen nature of the coat without it being made out of actual velvet. But yeah, I'm actually feeling a little more confident that maybe next year for Halloween I might do an Eighth Doctor costume. I'd have to get an Eighth Doctor sonic screwdriver, or I could just go all anachronistic and be like, I'm using my future self sonic this time. But yeah, I'd have to find a place that sells like navy blue ascots or something, but because though. But other than that, it's a really great coat. I mean, it's probably. Yeah, I love this coat. I won't wear, I don't think I'd wear it all the time, mind you, but it's still pretty impressive, nevertheless. But yeah. I mean, you'll probably get a better look at it in my custom thumbnail for this video anyway, so. I've been rambling for 20 minutes, and Lord knows how long it's going to take in between, like, the intro and this. So this might be a rather long video, so if you don't have patience, so I apologize for all the rambling, but I think that about does it for this video. So till my next video, whether it's a Let's Play, playing video games first time video, or a boss fight video, and yes, I'm aware I still need to do more of those. I've been meaning to do them, but it's just haven't had the time. But anyway, until then, just be awesome to one another. Keep on gaming, and thank you all. Just thank you all for watching. And just if you're a Who fan, maybe I'll see you at LI Who, at another LI Who again, either next year or any other year I decide to attend. So see you until next time. Have a good one. Bye.